In this module, we'll review the standards-based characteristics of single-mode fiber strands and cables for building and campus-based networks. Single-mode fiber, or SMF, cabling deployments can be divided into two groups. The first is long-distance or long-haul, where cable segments multiple kilometers in length are spliced together to link buildings within a city or in different cities, countries, or continents. The most important characteristic of the single-mode fibers in these deployments is very low attenuation, or signal loss. This minimizes the number of repeaters needed to regenerate signals along the length of the span. The second type of SMF cabling deployment is within buildings, where relatively short cable segments, typically less than 1 kilometer in length, are used to link network devices in places such as homes, office buildings, hospitals, university campuses, and data centers. Two examples of this type of deployment are fiber to the home, or FTTH, where single mode fiber delivers internet services to residences, and passive optical local area network, or PoLAN, where single-mode fiber is used to link all network devices within a single building or a multi-building campus. The most important characteristic of the single-mode fibers in these deployments is the ability to tolerate tight turns, bending, and pinching without signal loss or light leaking out of a fiber. Our next stop is a look at single-mode fiber cables and single-mode fiber strands. From a standards perspective, it's important to make a distinction between optical fiber cables and the individual fiber strands they contain. There are different standards that apply to each. Fiber cables, including cords or jumpers, are designed to protect the strands within from various environmental conditions, both indoors and especially outdoors. One extreme example is a submarine fiber cable that's dropped to the bottom of an ocean. Let's now take a close-up look at the strands. An uncabled single-mode fiber strand consists of three parts or layers, two of which are made of glass and the third of an acrylate or plastic. The innermost layer is the glass core that transports the light-based signals, measuring in the range of 8.5 to 9.5 micrometers or microns. For reference, 1 millimeter equals 1,000 microns. Surrounding the core, we have the glass cladding with different optical characteristics than the core, which serves to reflect the light and keep it contained in the core, preventing it from leaking out. The combined diameter of the core and the cladding is 125 microns, or 1/8 of a millimeter. And the outermost layer of a single-mode fiber strand is the acrylate or plastic coating, which allows for the movement and handling of the very delicate glass core and cladding without breakage. Adding this coating doubles the diameter of the strand to 250 microns, or 1/4 of a millimeter. Next, we'll finish off this module with an overview of the applicable standards for single-mode fiber, starting with the strands. The telecommunications standardization sector of the International Telecommunication Union, or ITUT, publishes the G-series standards for single-mode fiber strands that have been adopted globally. The U.S. equivalent standard is the TIA-492-CAAC. These documents specify the standards for both non-bend-insensitive and bend-insensitive fibers. As listed and shown here, standardized fiber strands can tolerate a bend radius ranging from 30 millimeters down to 5 millimeters, and some manufacturers can go even lower, all the way down to 2.5 millimeters. It's up to the cabling system designer to select and specify the minimum bend radius requirements for fiber strands, based on the intended and less than ideal unintended handling, as shown here. Let's now move on to single-mode fiber cable standards. The TIA-568.3 standard, currently in Edition E, specifies the use of optical single-mode 2 or OS2 rated cables for building and campus networks. The fiber strands within these cables are specified in TIA-492 CAAC, as described previously. The optical loss or attenuation performance of an OS2 rated cable depends on its construction. Tight buffered indoor cables have higher allowable losses than loose tube outdoor cables, with indoor-outdoor cables somewhere in between, as listed here. Here's an example of an outdoor OS2 rated single mode cable. Note the vendor's specification of the type of fiber strands it contains. In this case, it's G.657.B3 bend insensitive fibers, with a minimum 5 mm bend radius. The last type of standard to review is for the network applications that operate over the OS2 rated cables. The maximum allowable length of OS2 rated cable between two network devices depends on the application or type of network, so the cabling system designer needs to consider both current and expected future requirements. The TIA-568.0 standard, currently in edition E, lists the supportable distances and maximum allowable end-to-end channel attenuation values for various types of networks. Examples include 10, 40, and 100 gigabit Ethernet, as listed here. That's it, we're done. Thanks for watching.